We'll now have a special vocal performance by Sister Victoria Hardy, accompanied by Sister Deborah Robertson, entitled Savior, Redeemer of My Soul, and Called to Serve, a medley. Sister Hardy is a returned missionary earlier this year from the Mexico City West Mission. After the solo, we'll be pleased to hear from Dr. Daniel K. Judd, who is a member of the Ancient Scripture Department here at Brigham Young University. He is a close friend to President and Sister Killpack, and we'll introduce them to the audience. We will then hear from Sister Killpack and then President Killpack. Following President Killpack's address, we will conclude by singing as a congregation, How Firm a Foundation. We will sing the three verses that are printed on the back of the program, and the benediction will then be offered by Caleb Kaapu, and now the special musical number by Sister Hardy and Sister Robertson.
Whose wondrous power hath Victoria and Deborah, that was magnificent. Thank you. Well, elders and sisters, there are 411 mission presidents and their wives somewhere in the world today, tonight, that are praying for you as their missionaries that are soon to join them. And President Sister Killpack represent these mission presidents and wives well. These are two marvelous individuals who have been prepared by the Lord for literally thousands of years to be doing what they're doing right now, tonight, as well as serving their missionaries here in the mission field. President Chris Daniel Killpack and Sister Shelby Williams Killpack are the parents of 6 children and 11 grandchildren, 5 of whom we share, and I'm so grateful for that. Our oldest son married their oldest daughter. Some call that an arranged marriage. We're in the same state, but worked out extremely well. The Killpacks currently reside in the Orem, Utah Cascade Stake, where the Utah Orem Mission Home is located. President Killpack is a former stake president, stake mission president, bishop, high counselor, stake young men president, Sunday school teacher, ordinance worker in the Mount Timpanogos Temple, and missionary in the California Anaheim Mission from 1978 to 1980. President Killpack graduated from Brigham Young University with a Bachelor of Science degree in engineering and a Master's in Business Administration. At the time of his call, he was a CEO of a technology firm. President Killpack has been involved in scouting for many years and served as on the executive board of Utah National Parks Council, and is the recipient of the Silver Beaver and Outstanding Eagle Scout Awards. President Killpack was born in Provo, Utah, to Lovell Albert Killpack Jr. and Beverly Jean Brown Killpack. Sister Killpack is a former young women and primary president, Relief Society teacher, Sunday school teacher, ward music chairman, stake young women camp advisor, stake cultural arts specialist and service missionary for seminaries and institutes. She attended BYU, where she was a member of the Young Ambassadors. Maybe she'll sing for us tonight, perhaps. And also the Mormon Youth Symphony and Chorus. Sister Killpack was finishing her bachelor's degree here at BYU when she was called to serve the mission. Her interests include spending time with her family, gardening, sewing, cooking, tennis, and music. She was born in Santa Barbara, California, to Harold Williams and Doramus Sumter Williams. As I said earlier, the Killpacks are just wonderful people that we've known for some 20 plus years. We love them dearly, and I know that you'll be very blessed by having them speak to you tonight. So, Sister and President Killpack, honored to be with you. We love you.
We're going to come to the microphone together for just a brief moment.
Because we're companions, we stick together.
And as we're here with each of you, we wanted to just express to you how much we appreciate you and love you. We recognize because you're engaged in missionary work, we'd like to interact with you just a little bit more as well. Those of you who know the missionary purpose, would you stand and with each of us, can we recite that together? Those of you who know the missionary purpose?
Oh.
And if you haven't learned it yet, you will very soon.
Our purpose is to invite others to come unto Christ by helping them receive the restored gospel through faith in Jesus Christ and his atonement, repentance, baptism, receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost, and enduring to the end.
How great is our calling?
Thank you. There was a lone missionary on the front row that from our mission that said that. You'll meet him in a minute. You'll meet them in a minute. So while we're here together, we have an opportunity just to share a vision of what we hope you will all come to appreciate and understand, and that's the vision that Heavenly Father sees for each of you. And as we take a moment or two just to describe that, I want to point out that the ballroom that you are seated on many, many years ago was the exact spot that Sister Killpack and I met after having gone to high school for some time in the same community, but not dating, we knew who each other were. But I came to a freshman orientation dance right after my mission in the fall of the year that I returned, and came to a dance here. And toward the end of that evening, looking across the way, I noticed someone from the high school that I attended, and it happened to be this beautiful young lady standing before you now. So I approached her, and we danced a few of the final dances of that dance. The next day, it was Sunday, and we happened to live in the same stake. So I wanted to just share very briefly an important part of our becoming companions then, but also an important process of pursuing what's important in life. So it was that next day on a Sunday, there was a fireside. Sister Killpack mentioned to me there that that stake fireside was there, and she was attending, and if I had an opportunity, I should probably attend too, so I thought that would be a good idea. And so as I came from another church meeting to that meeting, I sat down on the aisle of this chapel, and lo and behold, in front of me, leading the music to that wonderful fireside, was this beautiful lady that I danced with the night before. So as I saw her leading the music, directing the music for all of us to sing to, she was scanning the congregation, encouraging us along, singing with us, and she and I made eye contact with each other. And I did something very brave and quite
bold.
And I winked at her. And as I winked at her, I knew it had an effect, because she turned bright red and she got off beat on the music. And so in my heart I said, aha, I'm going to pursue that. And here we are, all these wonderful years later, all from the beginnings of where you are tonight. What a blessing it is to be back here again, reminiscing over the blessings of the pursuit of those things that are most important, eternal relationships, and building upon our faith in Jesus Christ. So, sweetheart, I love you.
Love you.
Thanks for all you do, and I'll let you carry on. So, dear brothers and sisters, pursue the dream.
But you have to wait a little while if you're going on a mission, so. Well, what a joy it is to be here with you tonight. I walked in here and I thought, this is just a little bit of heaven. Those of you who are pursuing that goal to serve missions, those who are just pursuing life and having those wonderful goals to be a righteous young man or young woman, and I'm so grateful for this opportunity to be with you. So as you pursue your personal goals and looking forward to your futures, keep in mind your vision of who you can become and who Heavenly Father desires you to be. We challenge you to pray for guidance that you can effectively prepare for service as a missionary as well as a disciple of Jesus Christ through the rest of your life. We absolutely love our mission call. It has been such a delight the last year and a few months to be able to have the opportunity to rub shoulders with so many wonderful young men and young women. Because our mission is in Utah, we have one missionary from Utah that's serving our mission right now. But everybody else is from all over the world. We have from Mongolia and England and Brazil and lots of different countries and all over the United States. And it's such a joy to be able to be with them and know that they were some of them raised in the gospel of Jesus Christ and come to our mission and are pursuing that goal that they've had. And we actually have a few return missionaries here that have been serving our mission, and we're grateful to have them here. But as you think about those goals that you have as wanting to become a missionary, those pursuits are wonderful and beautiful and something that is a great desire in your heart. We absolutely love doing what we do because we can see a change in these young men and young women. As they come to our front porch from the MTC, fresh out of the MTC, they drive in a van 5 miles away, I guess is about to the mission home. And they come to our door, and we stay inside the house while the assistants go and pick them up. And they come and sing Call to Serve at our front door. And it just, I cry every time. It just touches my heart knowing that they are prepared and are willing to give their heart and mind and soul to our Savior Jesus Christ to serve and be his disciples. They've worked hard to prepare. They've studied the scriptures and preached my gospel. They've prayed for guidance. And they've worked to earn money for their missions. They've learned how to be self-reliant. They have prepared to attend the temple. They've focused on righteousness and keeping the commandments. They've had a vision of what it might be like to be a missionary. So I can tell you what you think it might be like, it's sort of close. It's not completely. So many get to the mission field and say, wow, this is so different than I thought it was. But I always ask them, are you prepared in your heart to be a missionary? Are you prepared because you've read the Book of Mormon, you've studied the scriptures? And most of the time they say yes. And I say, okay, carry on. Let's just keep moving then. We'll keep learning together. I want to focus my words tonight more on the practical side about missionary work. And that is of the physical, mental, and social and spiritual experiences you'll have. As you think about the demands of missionary service, it's probably not like what you think it is. In our mission, we have car share, meaning some weeks you'll have a car and other weeks you don't. There's a lot of walking. We have biking and different things. And so it'll be different in every mission you're at. But being prepared physically makes a huge difference. So I challenge you to do that. Along with that, and this is the missionaries who have been in our mission know about portion distortion. And we talk about that as far as healthy eating. We have a lot of missionaries that even come from the MTC and say, wow, I ate too much there. I need to cut back on eating. But there's many ways that you can stay healthy being a missionary, and that is not thinking about portion sizes too much desserts and things like that. So keeping healthy and walking and being able to keep your health in good tact that way. I was going to mention one thing. There was a mission president that one of the missionaries came up to him and he asked him, he said, I'm really struggling right now. I'm struggling, I'm depressed, I'm having a hard time. And the mission president said, so Elder, what did you have for breakfast? And he said, ice cream. And he says, what did you have for lunch? And he said, French fries. And he says, what did you have for dinner? And he says, French fries and ice cream. Can't get them apart. He says, how long have you been eating just French fries and ice cream? And he says, well, about a month. And he says, here's your assignment. Go home and eat something green, but not ice cream. So this mission president was trying to instruct him and help him to eat healthier. So there's many things that we can do to be healthy, and those are some of them. The mental part of it is adjusting to missionary life is essential, keeping stable mentally and emotionally. Whether you come into a mission with many successes under your belt or a few, if you are humble, teachable, and willing to keep trying and working, the Lord can work with you. But your missionary skills will only improve as you practice. So ask questions to get help and keep trying. If you are convinced that people are just naturally good or naturally bad at missionary work, languages, testimony, relationships, you'll have a hard time. A missionary once said, I've had to learn that it's the Lord's work, not mine, and it's okay if I feel inadequate at it because I am adequate. I'll never be adequate to do what God only can do. There's a lot I can do to improve, but I don't have to figure it out all by myself. I can count on him, and that's what you need to do. Having a good attitude makes a huge difference. A bad attitude is like a flat tire. You can't go anywhere until you fix it. The social part of it, learning to love people, learning to be bold, learn to talk to people and ask questions. Try looking at an object you see at your home or something else and try and think about how you could describe that as an object and how you can get that to a gospel principle. We had our missionaries do that, and it was really fun to see what they came out of it. So if they see a picture on the wall of something and try to make that into a gospel principle, it helps you to think about things and talk and be open to people. Miracles can happen as well in that situation. I want to share a small miracle that on Temple Square, the sister missionaries, that's what they're challenged to do is when people come to the Temple Square, they want to introduce themselves and then they look at something on Temple Square and they start talking about that as an introduction to get into the gospel topic. There was a young man, I went to his baptism this last Saturday, and he worked at McDonald's in Salt Lake, and he just happened to get off work a little bit early. And he just had moved to Salt Lake, so he didn't know the area very well. But as he got off work and went walking, he kind of got lost. And he went through, happened to go through Temple Square, and the sister missionaries started talking to him and started talking about an object, and then it got into the conversation and said that he was not a member of the church. He didn't know anything about the church. And so they had this conversation with him, and they referred him to our missionaries in the Utah Our Mission. And he took the lessons for about 4 weeks, and then he was baptized. But as I talked to him at the after his baptism this last Saturday, he said, you know, it was really a miracle. He says, I felt something was changing in my life, and I didn't know what it was. And then when he happened to get lost on Temple Square, he said, I got lost for a reason. And there are miracles like that. There are people that you will go teach in the mission field that are prepared by Heavenly Father to be able to come and to join the church. So we see those miracles all the time. There's a missionary once said, when people said a mission was going to be hard, I assumed it meant it'd be a difficult time for me. But for me, the hardest part was what goes on in my head, like feeling discouraged or getting frustrated with companions or not liking talking to strangers, just as dealing with all the ups and downs and rejections and change. So when you're prepared emotionally, this can help you to be able to do those things as you're talking and opening your mouth at situations. So as missionaries, sometimes they get a little bit discouraged because it's hard. But President Monson gave this quote. He says, stick to your task till it sticks to you. Beginners are many, but enders are few. Honor, power, place, and praise will always come to the one who stays. Stick to your task till it sticks to you. Bend at it, sweat at it, smile at it too. For out of the bend and out of the sweat and a smile will come, life's victories after a while. I love that. And then he has a talk, President Monson has a talk that he's from several years ago. He called Finishers Wanted. And this is his story. He says, on sunlit days during the noon hour, the streets of Salt Lake City abound with men and women who for a moment leave the confines of the tall office buildings and engage in that universal delight called window shopping. On occasion, he says, I like to be a participant too. One Wednesday, he says, I paused before the elegant show window of a prestigious furniture store. That which caught my eye, held my attention, was not a beautifully designed sofa, nor the comfortable appearing chair that stood at its side. Neither was it beautiful chandelier positioned at the overhead. Rather, my eyes rested upon a small sign that had been placed in the bottom right-hand corner of the window. Its message was brief, and it said, Finishers Wanted. The store had need of those persons who possessed the talent and the skill to make that ready for the final sale of an expensive furniture store and a firm manufactured sold of the furniture that they sell. It said, Finishers Wanted. The words remained with me, he said, as I returned to the pressing activities of the day. And so his point was, Finishers Wanted, sticking to the task till it sticks to you. So as a missionary in anything you're pursuing, it's important that we engage ourselves in that with whole heart and soul. Listening to your sorry, when you're praying and having those experiences to know what you need to do as a missionary and be able to come being healthy and having a mental and emotional and physical well-being together all encompasses when you are striving to be the best missionary that you can be. I want to bear my testimony that I know that this gospel is true. I'm so grateful for each of you who are pursuing that path of righteousness and to be able to come into Christ as you prepare. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
So, elders and sisters, as we have an opportunity to continue on this process of pursuit and looking forward to those four important aspects of being missionaries well prepared, I wanted to visit for a moment for us to understand the blessings that our unique message to the world is the restored gospel of Jesus Christ. That is what sets us apart from all others. And I thought it would be an opportunity for each of you to be introduced in a special way. So I've invited three of our missionaries from our mission to come up and share with you, if they would, what they share most often, and that is the message of the restoration in a very brief form. I'd like to invite Elders Fenton, Elder Sangster, and Elder Wilcox to come up, introduce where they're from, and then share with you this message that they've prepared for you to share and hear tonight. Elders? We'll have them use the musical mic and come stand over there.
I'm Elder Wilcox. I'm from Houston, Texas.
I'm Elder Sangster. I'm from Detroit, Michigan.
I'm Elder Fenton. I'm from Canton, Ohio.
Today we'd love to share a message with you that's very near and dear to our hearts that helps people come closer to Heavenly Father and Jesus Christ. That most important part of it to understand is to know that God loves us, each and every one of us, and we are His children, and He wants us to know that He is there.
I testify of that love that He does have for us, and He shows us that love in so many different ways, and one of those ways being families. This gospel is centered on families, and as we live the gospel of Jesus Christ within those units, Heavenly Father has promised us that our families can be together for time and all eternity. And I testify that that is true.
Because Heavenly Father loves us so much, He's blessed us with prophets, seers and revelators upon the earth to direct us as His children so that we can one day live with them in the celestial kingdom. I know that prophets are able to help us return as we follow their counsel because they follow the counsel of the Savior. Because of their great calling, they have the opportunity to testify of Jesus Christ.
I know and bear witness of what my companion shared with you previously, and I know that Jesus Christ is our Savior. And I know that as we follow His example that He set for us, including being baptized and keeping the commandments and doing the Father's will, that we'll find happiness and salvation. I know the most important thing that Jesus Christ did for us as the atonement, and how it enables us to be able to be forgiven of things we've done wrong, and also to be healed from not just mistakes, but pains that we feel each day.
I testify that Jesus Christ is the Savior, but after He was crucified, after He was killed, the people began to change the message that He once taught, and that pure and simple gospel was lost, and the priesthood authority that we needed to return to Heavenly Father was taken off of the earth. But Heavenly Father, He loves each of His children, and He loves us today. And so He restored the gospel to the earth again through the form of the prophet boy, Joseph Smith.
Joseph Smith is known as the prophet of the restoration. As a boy, he was questioned with many churches. He needed to know which religion he needed to join. He didn't know what was true and what was not. And as he searched the scriptures, he found a way that he could receive an answer. In the scripture of James, chapter 1, verse 5, he read, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him." He knew that he needed to pray. And so he went to a grove of trees behind his home, which are now called sacred. And he offered up his heart and his soul to our Father in heaven. And he received an answer to his prayer in the form of a vision. And I want to give this to you in his own words, his own account. Before I do, I want to impress upon your hearts the sanctity of this message and of this experience that he had, that it is real. As you pray about it, you will receive an answer. Joseph Smith said, "I saw a pillar of light exactly over my head, above the brightness of the sun, which descended gradually until it fell upon me. When the light rested upon me, I saw two personages whose brightness and glory defy all description. Standing above me in the air, one of them spake unto me, calling me by name, and said, while pointing to the other, Joseph, this is my beloved son. Hear him. I testify with all of my heart and soul, as a duly ordained minister of Jesus Christ, that I know Joseph Smith is a prophet. I know that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that he appeared to the boy in that grove of trees that day."
Well, to bear my witness as well, that Joseph Smith is truly a prophet of God, who's restored the church of Jesus Christ to the earth. I know that the priesthood authority, which was lost, has been restored as well. And the same miracles Jesus Christ and his apostles performed are performed once again. I know that we have received a physical evidence that the Church of Jesus Christ has been restored, and that is the Book of Mormon. And it is truly centered on Jesus Christ and the teachings that he wants us to know about, which is my favorite scripture in Jacob chapter 2, verse 8. It says, "For it supposeth me that they have come up to hear the pleasing word of God, yea, the word which healeth the wounded soul." And I know that as we use the Bible and the Book of Mormon both, that we'll be able to find peace and the validity and importance of reading his word.
I add my testimony to what my companions have said, that everything that we have shared today is true. The Book of Mormon is the word of God. As we read it, as we apply it, it will change our lives. And this message is the most important message that we have to share. And as missionaries, we leave invitations everywhere that we go. And we want to extend an invitation to everyone that is here today to read the Book of Mormon consistently each day, and to pray and to gain a divine testimony, a divine witness from the Holy Spirit that the book is true. And for each of you as well, whether you're going on a mission, whether you're not 100% sure, to pray and ask Heavenly Father to know what you can do today to prepare to serve a mission. We know that as you do that, Heavenly Father will answer that prayer, that you will feel the power of God in your life. We testify that. We testify the Savior Jesus Christ, that he lives. And we leave that witness in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, elders. So as you go forth in your lives, elders, just one quick question. Is there a vision of what you want to accomplish, or how you see yourselves going forth as missionaries? Is there anything that guides you in that vision of what you want to do?
The Utah Orem mission consists of missionaries who live what they teach. We are here to do what Jesus would do if he were in our area and position. We are here to do the Father's will as found in the scriptures, preach my gospel, the teachings of our leaders, and by following the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. We invite Heavenly Father in specific ways to help us, the members, investigators, and other missionaries do his work. Our motivation for service is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, hope in his atoning sacrifice, and charity, the pure love of Christ, with an eye single to the glory of God. We teach repentance and baptize converts. We are here to work with all of our heart, might, mind, and strength, and lose ourselves in the service to our fellow men. We study and plan daily to prepare ourselves to teach by the Spirit. We open our mouths at every opportunity to teach, and we find while we teach. We work with the unity as a mission according to the laws of the celestial kingdom. Success through obedience.
That's a pretty good vision, elders. Very unified as well. Thank you, elders, very much for your help. Can you see yourself? Do you have a vision of seeing yourself doing something like that around the world real soon? It's going to be amazing because you are amazing. And Heavenly Father is mindful of you. He loves you. He wants you to be successful. And as you rely on him and understand and recognize the atonement of Jesus Christ and exercise your faith, you will grow and develop and become whom the Lord needs you to be. The brethren oftentimes talk about how important it is for each of you to know who you are, to understand the work that you are or will be called to do, your life's vision, your life's goal, the things that he needs you to do, that he is calling you to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. As you understand that you can do that work, that you have the capacity through the grace of Jesus Christ, you'll be made equal to the opportunities of which you'll have to serve and lift and love. It will be wonderfully tremendous and amazing, the things that you will do. You will be astonished yourselves at the things that God will do to help you be an instrument in his hands to love and bless his children. Wherever you go, whether you've served or whether you're now preparing to go, in whatever phase of that preparation, as we all stood at the beginning of the meeting, may you feel the love of Heavenly Father as you ask him personally for the help you need. As you ask, the Spirit will provide to you promptings to know what you should do. I promise you that as you do so, you will find those miracles in your own lives. Even on the days you don't see them, they will occur. And as you look with an eye of faith, you will come to understand and recognize that God is involved in the details of your life and in the lives that he puts in your path. So may we all enjoy the experiences that we'll have. I want to relate to you just another experience of a young man. As you come to appreciate the experience of this young man and what he went through as he strived to become a disciple of Jesus Christ, he began and went forth. So I'm going to set this up and then I'll talk about him. So as we do, there's his picture. This young man, when he was 5 years old, he lived in a family and they were enjoying their lives together. When he was five, his father was murdered by a group of individuals who caused their entire family great discord and challenge in the community they lived in, and so he was forced with his mother and others to leave the community and travel some distance away. So as they then settled in into a new location and began to live their lives, then his mother passed away when he was 13. So now he was an orphan at 13. He was by himself, being raised by other extended family and others who were helping. Now at the age of 15, he was called to serve a mission for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. This young man's name is Joseph F. Smith. His father, Hiram, was martyred with the beloved prophet Joseph, his uncle. His mother, as they traveled to the Salt Lake Valley, within just a few short years, she also passed away. So he now finds himself being called and now serving a mission in a far off place then called Hawaii. He did not have any form of language study. He had to learn the Hawaiian language there, and it was very difficult and challenging. He said he would lay in a little tent, makeshift tent, and have struggles and difficulties. He recalled one thing that helped him the most through his mission was a sacred dream that allowed him to know that in the dream he was asked to hasten and quickly go to a meeting that his uncle, the prophet Joseph, wanted him to go to and be at. As you know from General Conference or other things you've heard possibly of that experience, he was carrying a bundle with him and hurrying along the path, noticed how dirty he was, and looked and noticed there was a bathhouse. He hurrying, washed up, noticed that bundle was clothing, he put them on and ran quickly to the meeting. As he arrived, they said, "Joseph, you're late, you're late." And he said, "Yes, I know I'm late, but I'm clean, I'm clean." Through the experience that he had, that sustained him along with a wonderful Hawaiian sister who he called his Hawaiian mother, blessed him. So now, as a 19-year-old returning missionary, having served for 3 years in Hawaii, he returns and comes across the Pacific Ocean. He lands in California and joins up with a wagon train coming across to Utah. At the time in history, there was a great deal of challenge and turmoil in the area. This was a time when the United States had sent an army to quell a rebellion in the Utah territories. Johnston's army was coming, and there were mobs around looking for Mormons. And if they found them, they were threatening to kill them. This was the occasion as Joseph F. joined this wagon train. He's coming across when a ruffian group of mobsters come upon their wagon train. Some of the men had noticed them coming and kind of slid off into the bushes. Joseph saw them and saw them approach. And recognizing and knowing what they could do, this is the situation setting up what we'll now watch.
In the fall of 1857, the 19-year-old Joseph F. Smith returned from his mission in Hawaii. In California, he joined a wagon train headed for Salt Lake City. It was a volatile time for the Saints. Johnston's army was marching towards Utah, and many had bitter feelings toward the church.
Yes, sirree. Dyed in the wool, true blue through and through.
Aren't you the pleasantest fellow I ever met?
Shake. Glad to see a fellow stand up for his convictions.
The men rode off and ceased their troubling persecution of the wagon train.
So how would that be for you? If you had the opportunity to come along and someone asked you, "Are you a Mormon?" What would you do? Well, as that experience occurred, President Nelson in 2014 in the Seminar for New Mission Presidents was speaking to mission presidents and talking about the qualities and characteristics that he felt would be important for all missionaries to have in their lives. President Nelson, president of the Quorum of the Twelve, said this: every missionary can have at least one convert on a mission, himself or herself. Not just a baptism, not just an attender, not just a name to be remembered, but a rock-solid, true blue, through and through disciple of Jesus Christ who will be an exemplary member and spouse long after the mission is over. So may each of you help me state that again. So we're going to be, it's rock-solid, true blue, through and through disciple of Jesus Christ. Will all of you commit yourselves to become that? So here we go. You ready? With me. Rock solid, true blue, through and through disciple of Jesus Christ. As we in our lives strive to become whom the Lord would have us be, He will help us to then be a pure vessel, one in which the Spirit can come and dwell and share and radiate the Spirit, even the gospel of Jesus Christ, to those amongst whom will be called to labor, that you'll be called to labor amongst his missionaries in the very near future. President Nelson also went on to say, we want converted missionaries and plenty of baptisms, but most of all, we want the grandchildren of our missionaries and the grandchildren of those whom your missionaries baptize to be endowed and sealed in the temple. We want multi-generational families of faith. God wants his children to return to him, converted, endowed, and sealed as families. So my beloved friends, as we look forward in our lives to find ways that we can accomplish this. It's my hope and prayer that we will recognize that we can be disciples. I'd like to turn to a reference in the scriptures in section 84 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Invite us just to look at the doctrine that is taught there in section 84, verse 106. It says this important truth. And if any man, and I'll put, or woman, among you be strong in the Spirit, let him take him. Take with him that is weak, that he may be edified in all meekness, that he may become strong also. So as you consider the doctrine that was just shared, let him take him that is weak, that he may become strong also, that he may be edified. Watch what I do. As you come to know how important it is, one by one, to see the effect that God will have on our lives as we look for the one. Pay close attention to what I'm about to do and see if you can also understand the principle that I'm trying to share with you. Are you ready? Okay, here goes. Well, Elder Fenton, I know who you are already, but I have an opportunity just to come and be with you, and it's grateful to see you now. Who noticed what I did? What happened? Yes. This is that you can share in this meeting. Shout it out. What happened? What did I do? I'm still holding him, aren't I? I went and did what? I went and got him, and I brought him up. And was I above him, or how did that happen? I knelt down to his level. I talked with him. I invited him to come with me, and then I brought him with me. Okay, watch.
He's a little bit taller than me.
Now what's happened? Okay, watch one more time. This is my friend Sam. He's an amazing young man, and I'm glad that he's come with me here tonight. So you can see what's happened. If we did this a total of 16 times, if I went and got one, and then they went and got one, and brought them back, after we did this 16 times, we'd have over 100,000 of us on the stage. Can you see the power of the one? One by one by one by one. That's how Heavenly Father does his work. One at a time. And his Spirit will come and touch and lift and illuminate the lives of those that we have an opportunity to see in our path. Look for the one in your path. It may be your companion in the mission field. It may be your roommate. It may be a family member. Always look for the one, and you'll be guided to help Heavenly Father do his work. Thank you so much. Amazing. Thank you. My beloved young friends, as we recognize the importance of God's work and know that we are his hands, we are his feet, we are his voice of encouragement, of lifting, of loving, of sharing our faith in Jesus Christ, that the gospel, that unique message, has been restored to the earth, we can make a difference, every one of us. And as we go forth and help one by one by one, great miracles will occur. Well, as we consider those things that we might do and we've learned this evening, I pray that we will focus on the opportunities that we'll have, that the Spirit will teach us of what we can do to be engaged in a great cause. Four important quick thoughts and principles. If we will increase our faith in our Heavenly Father and Jesus Christ and the atonement by becoming rock-solid, true-blue disciples of Jesus Christ, as we understand and begin with the end in mind is those wonderful families sealed together in the temple, that we will be worthy vessels, that we will keep our covenants, that we'll recognize the doctrine of Christ, those who quoted the missionary purpose, that's also called the doctrine of Christ. In the missionary purpose is stated the five doctrines of Christ: faith, repentance, baptism, or sacred ordinances, the Holy Ghost, receiving that sacred gift or listening to it as it comes in our lives, and the last, which is the smallest and the most important for each of us, to endure to the end, as we have the sacred privilege week by week partaking of the sacrament and renewing those sacred covenants. As we understand, as we've heard, the attributes of Christ, as you read section 4 of the Doctrine and Covenants, which is about missionary work, and look in chapter 6 of Preach My Gospel and notice and compare section 4 and page 126 of Preach My Gospel, the last page of chapter 6, as you read section 4, you'll notice in order the attributes of Christ. So if you want to be a fantastic, successful missionary, and as it says in section 4, you will be acquiring the attributes of Christ. The only one that's not in section 4 is the last one. And it's very important. You heard the missionaries as they talked about their vision of what they want to accomplish. The last one is obedience, the first law of heaven. The second, restoration of the gospel of Jesus Christ is our unique message to the world. The Book of Mormon is the keystone of our religion. As you come to know for yourself, it is true. You can read from the introduction to the Book of Mormon, those first two paragraphs, and then read the promise, the last paragraph, and apply that in your lives and invite everyone in your sphere of influence to do the same. You will be blessed. It will help you not only now on your missions, but forever if you read from the sacred words from the Book of Mormon every day. As we know and understand, Preach My Gospel, the name of the book that we study and use as missionaries, section 50 of the Doctrine and Covenants, verse 14, it says, preach my gospel by the Spirit. The Spirit is the teacher. We must have our lives in such a way and in order that the Spirit will guide us to teach and lift and love others. You'll come to realize the importance of the fundamentals of Preach My Gospel, though there are 8 specific lessons that you'll come to know more fully and faithfully during the first 12 weeks of your mission experience. Finally, third, the Lord is hastening his work in its time. From section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants, verse 73, that is true. We find constantly, as we teach repentance and baptize converts, you will never be able to baptize anyone in the mission field unless you've found them. You'll never be able to teach anyone in the mission field unless you've found them. Our most important part of missionary work is the beginning, and that's in the finding those who will be taught and baptized. We must always open our mouths, set the example, and be a light and a guide to those that we minister to. So as you go forth and you, in your personal vision, create for yourself those goals, those plans that will help you to be successful in your life's mission, The mission that Heavenly Father wants all of us to achieve is going home and coming home to Him. That's His goal, that's His mission, for all of us to return home to Him. That's His work and glory. I pray that each of us will recognize the ways that we can adjust our lives, our plans, our goals, living the schedule that you'll be required to keep in the mission field, a very rigorous schedule, but one if you adjust yourself now to will be very easy, and you'll be able to meet the rigors that you will receive. Also, having a strong work ethic will bless you. To work hard, to do hard things that stretch you, will bless you. There is technology that's available to you that will assist, many resources and references, blessings that you've had in your mission preparation classes, in the scriptures and everything else that you've been studying that will help, online resources on lds.org. Now, as I close and we share this last message, and Sister Killpack and I bear our testimonies, this is a reminder for you of who, how and why the Lord has chosen you, each of you, to be missionaries and representatives of the Savior as disciples to the people of the world. You are the future. Think of it. Most and many of you were in primary 6 years ago or so. And as you find yourselves with a missionary name tag on in the near future, think of and recognize this scripture found in section 1 of the Doctrine and Covenants, verses 19 through 24, which says, "The weak things of the world shall come forth and break down the mighty and strong ones, that man should not counsel his fellow men, neither trust in the arm of flesh, but that every man might speak in the name of God the Lord, even the Savior of the world, that faith might increase in the earth, that mine everlasting covenant might be established, that the fullness of my gospel might be proclaimed by the weak and the simple unto the ends of the world and before kings and rulers. Behold, I am God and have spoken it. These commandments are of me and were given unto my servants in their weakness after the manner of their language, that they might come to understanding." My beloved young friends, Heavenly Father is mindful of you. He knows exactly who you are. He knows you by name, and He will bless you as you move forward. Now in closing, may I just remind us all that in the coming days, we will have an opportunity to share the important message of the restored gospel. We're approaching the holiday season. That means finals for most of you, and other important things to prepare for. But as you prepare for all of those events that will transpire in your life, may I share with you just a simple example of something that the rest of the world will find out about in just a few minutes, a few weeks. And as they do so, let me just give you an idea and an understanding of what will be coming in the holidays. This will begin the day after Thanksgiving. This is a sneak peek for you. No one else in the world knows about this, so be prepared to do what it invites you to do. But the essence of the initiative this year is that we're going forward, and the initiative is called Be a Light. And President Monson shared this in General Conference: as we follow the example of the Savior and live as He lived and as He taught, that light will burn within us and will light the way for others. Two verses of Scripture, John 8:12, "I am the light of the world," and Matthew 5:14, "Ye are the light of the world." This year's initiative is titled Light the World. Now, we'll show you what the little short video that everyone will see the day after. Whoops. Here we go. Thank you. So on December 1st, which is National Service Day, all of us are invited to begin on the 1st of December and for the next 25 days have acts of service. You'll learn more about it on Mormon.org the day after Thanksgiving. We'll each strive in our lives to have a kind act of service just like the Savior, blessing, lifting, and being a light to the world. I testify that Jesus Christ is the light of the world. He loves us. He leads and directs this church, the Church of Jesus Christ upon the earth. I bear witness of him. He will bless all of us as we apply his atonement in our lives and change and repent every day.
As we felt the spirit of that video, I loved how it likens the scriptures or Jesus Christ to our own personal lives here in our day. It is our turn to shine and have that light within you to be able to share with others throughout the world, wherever you may be. We testify that these things are true, and I am excited for you to be able to have your journey going on, but taking that testimony and your firm foundation and always be a covenant person, always one who has your testimony bright to shine. I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. So think of it. There are mission presidents all over the world who will or have received a picture of you. They know you by name. They have your picture on the wall. They pray for you by name, and they're so excited to have you join them in their mission, in the labors that you'll be pursuing of lifting and loving others. They are grateful for your willingness to sacrifice so much that you sacrifice so that you can serve. And they, with all of the leaders of the church, pray for you. Millions of people pray for missionaries and those preparing and have recently returned and all of the youth of the church every day. There is a great focus on who you are and what you will and can become. May you recognize that as you unite with those amongst whom you'll labor, those who have been given priesthood keys by the members of the Quorum of the Twelve personally, to exercise those keys in loving all of Heavenly Father's children and inviting them to come to him. I pray that you will feel the love of God in your lives, know the love of wonderful mission presidents all over the world amongst whom you will labor. The gospel has been restored for all of Heavenly Father's children. May we live it, may we truly love it and share it. We bear our testimony to you that God lives and this is his work. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.